everyone, I'm Carol Anne Riddell, and welcome to Arts in the City. First up today, it takes quite an artist to design stages for Super Bowl halftime shows, operas, and the Olympics. You've probably seen and loved Es Devlin's amazing work. And now, as Donna Hanover shows us, you can step inside her studio at Cooper Hewitt Smithsonian Design Museum.
Es Devlin is a British artist renowned for stage designs for musical artists like The Weeknd at Coachella and other venues, U2 including their Innocence and Experience tour, Miley Cyrus performing on a stage echoing her famous tongue, and Adele and her mesmerizing Hello tour. Devlin has also done staging for Super Bowl halftime shows, the Olympics, the World Expo, Lincoln Center, and St. Paul's Cathedral. And now Cooper Hewitt Smithsonian Design Museum in New York has the first exhibit dedicated to her art, which people usually see when they're part of a crowd. Andrea Lipp is curator of the show called An Atlas of Es Devlin.
The exhibition begins in a replica of Es's London-based studio. This is inspired by early studio visits that I did with Es 5 years ago. Her studio is filled with white shelves, white walls that are chock full of models, ephemera, relics from past projects.
It's an immersive experience. Then something stunning happens.
Es's hands will open a studio wall and visitors are invited to enter the exhibition.
Es Devlin's large stage designs start with sketches and models like this one for Your Voices, an installation at Lincoln Center in 2022. Devlin was born in 1971 and says she has loved models since she was 6 years old.
I just moved from the suburbs of London, one of four children, and I had just moved to the seaside. Next to my house was a model of our town. Every house in the model told a story. There was a little voice coming out of the model houses.
She started her career doing stage design in little theaters with 75 seats, but her innovation caught the attention of bigger and bigger performers and directors. By 2022, she was designing the staging for a very special Super Bowl halftime show.
The artists that were chosen to perform, chosen by Dr. Dre, were Kendrick Lamar, Mary J. Blige, Eminem, Snoop Dogg, 50 Cent. The emotions that are expressed come very specifically from the city of Compton. So we made a map of Compton, filming it from above.
Es is interested in doing large-scale portraiture of celebrated performers. So there begins to be a sense of both intimacy and spectacle at a grand scale.
Es also loves big operas.
Every person who works in stage design wants to work at Bregenz Festival Opera on Lake Constance in Western Austria. The sculpture that you build becomes a public work of art for 2 years.
She did the staging for Carmen, which was seen by thousands of people every night. Hands that were more than 70 feet tall emerged from the lake.
In Act Three, when Carmen is looking at her fortune in a pack of cards, she reads that her fortune, her fate, is death, and she throws the cards in the air.
Devlin has also done art about our connections to animals, the planet, and each other. There's now a book of her life's work, edited by Lipp, that is full of foldouts and other surprises.
We wallpapered the entire gallery in every single page of the book.
People love it because it's so much like her stage designs.
Es is masterful at distilling a narrative to a singular form and making something unbelievably memorable for us.
The exhibit is open through August 11th. I'm Donna Hanover for Arts in the City.
From high design to slime, TV host Marc Summers is well known to fans of the game show Double Dare on Nickelodeon, which featured guests getting doused in green goo. Now he's taking his story to the stage in the Life and Slimes of Marc Summers. Andrew Falzon caught up with him.
On your mark, get set, go!
If you were a kid in the 80s and 90s, odds are this guy is a familiar face. As the host of Nickelodeon's Double Dare, which originally ran from 1986 to 1993, Marc Summers was the adult that every kid wanted in their lives. A grown-up who seemed to have no problem letting the kids run the show and getting entirely sloppy, even super sloppy, all in the name of having fun and winning some quintessentially 80s and 90s prizes.
New Mad Magazine skateboard. It's a pro-style deck complete with protective accessories. Equipped with full precision bearings, knee and elbow pads are included.
Get set, go!
Now at age 72, Summers is taking on a new physical challenge. He's starring in an autobiographical production at New World Stages entitled The Life and Slimes of Marc Summers. It's an inside look at the highs and lows of an on-camera career filled with off-camera challenges.
I've had several lives, first on Nick and then on Food Network and a million things in between. So, you know, a lot of failures. Two that stand out as successes, but you know, I've hosted over 25 shows and most people can't mention any of them other than the two I just mentioned.
Sure.
So, but you just keep hoping that somebody's gonna hire you and you know, the career continues.
Hi, welcome to Unwrapped. I'm Marc Summers, and today...
Marc's second major success after Double Dare was hosting and executive producing the culinary infotainment series Unwrapped, which was the number one show on the Food Network at the height of its success. However, in between the major successes that were Double Dare and Unwrapped, Summers faced a career downturn after being diagnosed with obsessive-compulsive disorder, more commonly known as OCD.
It kind of put a halt to my career for a while. Nobody wanted to hire me because they thought I was crazy. And so that was challenge number one.
While commonly known today, in 1995, when Summers announced he had OCD on his Lifetime talk show, few had heard of the condition.
In our next segment, we're going to talk about OCD. And this is something that I have.
And there was stigma attached to it. The disorder takes on the role of co-star in the show, and for quite some time, it took center stage in Marc's life.
I think the comforter on your bed is just a tiny bit off. Wouldn't want anything to happen to your kids now, would you?
All right, that's not funny. How'd you get this number? Who is this?
Pulling together a stage production of Marc's life was a 10-year journey that includes director Chad Rabinowitz and composer Drew Gasparini.
From a musical perspective, if Marc Summers was a chord, like, it sounds like there are some major moments, but there have been some minor and minor seventh moments.
I love how you just put that. In fact, if I were to call him a chord, he would be my G minor seven. Absolutely. Nice and moody, but there's a little lift in there. The world just doesn't know. What's weirder is our G minor seven, Marc Summers. He was on Oprah Winfrey telling this story. Still, nobody seems to grasp what he is saying. The messiest game show in history, battling a debilitating condition with OCD. If that doesn't scream somebody you're rooting for, the hero of a piece, I don't know what does. So I think there is the trouble, but he colors it with the joy. There's our G minor seven.
And the show also involves some potential audience participation. Guests can enter their names in advance of the show to be called up on stage as part of some real-life Double Dare games.
As you can see, there are plenty of authentic props from the original Double Dare, all recreated for the stage version. We had a slime bucket here. They're going to have real slime during the show. But probably the best piece on stage is the giant nose from Picket, which actually serves as a metaphor for some of the physical challenges Marc dealt with during his life.
It's been really fulfilling to be able to learn more about someone that I cared about so much on a surface level at a young age, and now to learn what he was going through at that time that I remember watching him and say, okay, how do we tell that story in a way that reminds me what it felt like to watch it as a kid, but gives me that complexity of what it's like to understand this about him now and find that inspiration of who he is to be here on this stage today.
And who he is today was shaped by obstacles, including a cancer diagnosis that recurred twice and a car accident in which he broke every bone in his face. Yet through it all, Summers just kept going, all the way to New World Stages here in New York City.
I always hear from people, wow, that was a great show, but I had no idea it was going to be that. And I think positivity, optimism, and never giving up.
I'm Andrew Falzon for Arts in the City.
Next, our Patrick Pacheco chats with Stan Brown, an actor and voice coach who made his Broadway debut in his 60s in the hit play Water for Elephants, which just earned 7 Tony nominations, including Best Musical.
You made your Broadway debut at the age of 61 in Water for Elephants. Yeah. How did that feel?
I'm just grateful, I think, more than anything else. I've always loved acting. I've done it my entire life. Acting on Broadway, it became sort of a dream deferred in my 30s. I couldn't get an agent to meet with me, let alone to represent me. So I just went in other directions. And education, being a teacher, being a vocal coach and that type of things, it supplied what I couldn't get, you know. And so, but I took acting gigs, big gigs or whatever, but it's an honor to be here. I'm so happy that I get to do a play on Broadway before I leave the planet.
The role that brought Stan to Broadway was as Camel, a seasoned veteran of a Depression-era circus in the acclaimed musical Water for Elephants, based on Sarah Gruen's bestseller, which was also made into a film. Originally, Stan's character was white, but in many profound ways, Stan changed that.
I was discussing with them, they were saying he was a gunner in the war. I said, well, African Americans weren't really allowed to have artillery up until like World War II. And so I wanted to craft a history for him that was faithful to somebody who was an African American. There was one elite squadron, I think, in France of African American soldiers.
In the musical, Camel welcomes a lonely young man, Jacob Jankowski, and shows him the ropes. Camel's just learned about his demotion from carnival barker to lowly ticket seller.
I'll bet he was a wonderful barker in his day.
I have fun doing that moment when I'm telling him what the bark is. That is a fun moment in the show, and one of my favorite lines is in that, where it's step right up and put some wind in your sails, because that certainly speaks to the life I've had to live.
That wind in Stan's sails floated him to over 46 places around the world as an actor, educator, and vocal coach. It started with a challenge to his career, which he received early on at the Shakespeare Theater in Washington, D.C.
One of the many voice teachers that I had cornered me one day, and I realized in retrospect why it was made a private moment, cornered me and told me that I was never going to be able to master Shakespeare because the English language did not belong to black people. Now, of course, if that happened today, that teacher probably would have been fired or some reprimand or at least mediation or something. But back then, I probably would have gotten into trouble for saying anything. And so I survived that moment. And then fast forward to my first teaching job, full-time teaching job, upstate New York. I was coaching a production of Carol Churchill's Cloud Nine. And the student actor stopped me and said, well, how can a black person teach voice and speech? And so those two things sort of coalesced and put me on the path that I'm on right now.
When you had these moments with a teacher and a student, were you enraged?
The rage didn't come until after. It was such a shocking moment. You're like, you don't know how to respond. With the teacher, I remember thinking, this is someone that's trying to get you. And so, again, this was a long time ago. And so one had to be very strategic in moments like that. And so I responded with silence. But again, it put me on the path that I'm on now, and I'm grateful for it.
Stan responded to those insults with a creative fervor that led him to a stint at the Royal Shakespeare Company in Great Britain as a guest of the voice department, working with Cicely Berry, the late world-renowned voice coach.
I met on a train while reading her book across the aisle from her, you know, talk about a gift, and she became a mentor and, you know, and guided my career. But England was about, I guess, finding my way, but Shakespeare was the lens through which I was looking when I went there.
What's your favorite Shakespeare play?
Oh, my goodness. Winter's Tale comes to mind. I've directed the Scottish play a couple of times. Yeah, I think those two.
What's fascinating about Winter's Tale is that it's so hopeful.
Yeah.
Are you a hopeful kind of guy?
I try to be. Yeah. I like to beat the drum of the solution more than the drum of the problem.
Yeah. How has the life that you've led as variously as possible left you with who you are today?
The perspective, I think, has been the biggest gift. I've had to start over so many times in places where people didn't know anything about me, and so I couldn't rely on reputation or anything like that. I just had to work and do the best that I could, and that has, I'm very grateful for that, but it's made me a good friend with the present moment, you know, in terms of just knowing that's where my power is and, you know, not relying on, I don't know, favors and things like that.
Congratulations on a stirring debut. Welcome to Broadway.
Thank you.
And thank you for being with us.
Thank you. It's an honor to meet you.
I'm Patrick Pacheco for Arts in the City.
Now we head downtown to the Lower East Side. The Tenement Museum brings history to life by taking a look at how immigrants lived here in the city more than a century ago. And their new exhibit tells the story of a black family for the first time. Neil Rosen takes a tour.
New York's historic Tenement Museum evokes the history of immigration on Manhattan's Lower East Side, America's iconic immigrant neighborhood. The heart of the museum are two historic tenements on Orchard Street, which in the 19th and 20th centuries were the home predominantly to new arrivals in America from more than 20 nations as they struggled to make new and better lives for themselves. On walking tours, visitors can view apartments that were recreated to look exactly as they did back then, where often 10 people lived in a cramped one-bedroom apartment. Period retail spaces from different eras are also on display, while the surrounding neighborhood's history and culture and experiences of how immigrants weathered hard times are also examined. Kat Lloyd is the Vice President of Programs and Interpretation at the Tenement Museum.
So here we are in the hallway of 97 Orchard Street. This building is now home to the Tenement Museum, but it was a residence, a tenement, for over 7,000 people in 72 years. It opened as a home in 1863, closed as a home in 1935, and then was empty for 53 years. It was a tenement building, so there were 22 apartments in the building, over five floors, so really typical tenement. And in 1988, when the museum started out, there had never been a museum that told the stories of people who lived in these buildings, right? Immigrants, migrants, working class New Yorkers. And so our founders really had this vision that there could be a museum that would tell the stories of people who had lived in buildings like this, because more of our ancestors' stories are connected to the urban history of tenements than many other parts of the nation. And so we, over the years, have told the stories of real families who live in tenements, and everyone who ever lived in this building walked through the same door, through the same hallway.
A new permanent exhibit recently opened at the museum called The Union of Hope, 1869.
And our new exhibit about a black family, Joseph and Rachel Moore, is now on the fifth floor of this building. And Joseph and Rachel Moore lived in a tenement across town in today's Soho, and their building doesn't exist anymore. So in order to tell their story, we had to bring their story to 97 Orchard Street. And so we began researching him and his wife, Rachel, and their lives in tenements. And it opened this whole world that answered these questions that visitors have had for decades about where were the black families in tenements in the time periods that we were already talking about at the museum. And so that led us to actually do research into our own archives and learn that really our founder's vision for the museum was that we would tell the story of a black family in tenements. And so although this is new to us, this is the first time we're telling the story of a family who didn't live in this building. It's the first time we're telling the story of a black family in a permanent exhibit, but it's actually a return to our origin story and to our starting point as a museum. The other thing that we really invite visitors to think about during this exhibit is how black New Yorkers were forming community and institutions while trying to navigate what it meant to be free in a nation where slavery was still legal.
Throughout its history, the Tenement Museum looks at many different groups of people who made it their home. The neighborhood saw a wave of Jewish immigration at the turn of the 20th century, while Asians, Italians, Latinos, and many other groups lived here on the Lower East Side at various points over the years.
And these tenements really speak to, the stories of New Yorkers across backgrounds. right? The tenements by the turn of the 19th to 20th century, this was the main form of housing. 75% of New Yorkers lived in tenements by 1900. So although we don't use that word anymore, these buildings still stand and invite us to think about who lived there and how their stories connect to our own stories.
The Tenement Museum is open 7 days a week, and you can visit them at 97 Orchard Street. There's walking tours that are available, a great gift shop and bookstore, and you can also learn more about the new exhibit, A Union of Hope, 1869. To find out more information, go online at tenement.org. For Arts in the City, I'm Neil Rosen.
Art and science go hand in hand at Baruch College. An exhibit at the Mishkin Gallery explores the world of silkworms. Our intern Megan Gleason has more.
Silk is luxurious, we all know that, but how much do you know about how silk is made? The new exhibit, Taxonomies of Power, on display through June 7th at the Mishkin Gallery, may teach you a thing or two.
It's an interesting story of how human intervention has literally changed the livelihood of these little critters that fueled a huge economic empire and engine.
47 never-before-seen photos derived from plate glass negatives are making their New York debut, along with the film Raised in the Dust by Georgian filmmaker Andro Eredzi, which examines the relationship between humankind and nature. Curator Alaina Claire Feldman worked with Georgian curator Miriam Shagrilashvili from the State Silk Museum in Tbilisi, Georgia. They created this exhibit and invite guests to examine why these photographs are important.
There's something about that story of metamorphosis and being able to change oneself that's really beautiful and poetic and has been used, you know, through all kinds of cultures. So we hope that we attract people in by these beautiful classic photographs. But then I hope it helps people also think about the ways we've looked at and photographed and kind of categorized animals over time.
You might be surprised to learn silkworms and silk moths are, in a way, like pets.
What's really interesting about this story is that silkworms and silk moths are completely domesticated. They cannot live without human intervention.
The photos themselves aren't your standard scientific pieces. They have a distinct sense of artistry. Alaina took us through some of her favorites.
So it almost looks like the photographer was like spotlighting them as some kind of like pas de deux or something, you know? They're just mating and about to make new silkworms, so. But I love this progression on this wall. Seems like they were trying to show all stages and different kinds of, I don't know, amalgamations of these animals, but it really seems like a beautiful kind of seriality as an artwork also.
The gallery hopes exhibits like this challenge us to think about our place in the natural world.
So I really hope that people think, yeah, and rethink of the ways that we've captured animals and how we might be unaffording them agency of their own. This becomes really important when we start to think about the climate crisis, because ecologies are not just human ecologies. Humans have created the climate crisis, but we're not the only ones who suffer from it.
Silkworms may not be something you're thinking about in your day to day, but here at the Mishkin Gallery, they display the beauty of art and science working together. I'm Megan Gleason for Arts in the City.
We end today's show on a delicious note, Rugelach. The bite-sized pastry is filled with flavor, a traditional Jewish treat. And some of the best you can find is being made in Harlem by hand in a cross-cultural celebration of the sweet tooth. I got lucky with this assignment, a visit to Lily's Baked Goods.
At 82 years old, Alvin Lee Smalls is still making Rugelach the same way he has for decades, from scratch, with dedication, and only the best ingredients. And you can taste all three in every bite.
Nothing plastic here. Everything's real. Real ingredients, real everything.
Mr. Lee, as he's called, is a fixture in this Harlem neighborhood. He explains he first came to New York City in the 1960s, starting out in a hospital kitchen peeling onions. But he fell in love with baking, then saw a recipe for Rugelach in the newspaper and tinkered with it to develop it to his liking. Don't expect to try his version yourself. Those details are closely guarded.
And I experimented from the hospital at home, and I came up with this.
So do you tell anyone what's in that recipe, or is it a secret?
No, it's a secret.
It's a secret.
Yeah, I can say that I cooked the raisins and honey to make it nice and plump inside to make it moist.
And I did read that you said one of the key things is butter.
You gotta have butter.
Now, Mr. Lee is something of a Rugelach legend in New York and beyond. His sweets are shipped across the country and internationally.
Do people find it fascinating that you have become the expert? I mean, do you have like traditional Jewish families come and say,
I'm better than your grandmother. Yeah, that's what everybody said.
Lili's baked goods is filled with history. The bakery even created National Rugelach Day, landing on Mr. Lee's birthday. Rugelach is the star player here, featured on Mr. Lee's apron, socks, and watch. But you'll also find many other desserts, including cookies and cakes. He says he doesn't have to taste every treat himself after all these years.
I'll taste everything. I'll be like this, right? No. Not at all. I don't taste anything. I can look at this carrot cake and see that's right. Cheesecake, I see it's right. Everything.
Being an amateur myself, I opted for the in-person sample.
Wow. No way. That is butter. That is our show for today. Thanks so much for watching. A quick reminder to check us out on social media. We'd love to hear from you. I'm Carol Anne Riddell. See you next time on Arts in the City.